the Holy Spirit, the power of love. The Holy Spirit who keeps the Father and the Son together in love, in eternal union of intimacy, the bond of love, a love that becomes so perfect, the three, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are one. This love, this bond of love is what we are praying for, because we are also called to live together and exercise our ministry in a relationship of love. Let's sing together with our hands open in front of us, with our hearts open to God. Let's sing together, waiting for the Holy Spirit to anoint us afresh.
Welcome, Holy Spirit.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John, chapter 13. Verses 33 and 34 and 35. My children, I will be with you only a little while longer. You will look for me, and as I told the Jews, where I go, you cannot come. So now I say to you, I give you a new commandment. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you also should love one another. This is how all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. The Gospel of the Lord. A story is told of a critic. Who is a critic? We speak about literary critics, right? Political critics, financial critics. Critics are people who evaluate and find fault and warn the leaders. Critics. But in normal parlance, critic is a person who finds fault with everyone. With everyone. Everywhere they find fault. A critic was once bitten by a dog. And soon the critic knew it was a man. Dog. So he was going to get mad. And he asked his friend to bring a piece of paper and pen. He began to write fast. The friend asked him, "What are you writing?" The critic said, "I'm writing the names of everyone I should go and bite when I become mad. I will not spare anyone." You know, my dear fathers and sisters and brothers, we are excellent critics, aren't we? We are trained to find fault with others. And because of that, the hurts, the jealousy, the rivalry, the enmity, the ill feelings that split us, that separate us who are the leaders in evangelization, leaders in the vineyard of the Lord. We are not famous to love and understand each other. We are going to offer ourselves to the mercy of God. We offer ourselves for sanctification to flow into our hearts. And one area we must look into very carefully is the area of our relationships. When there's a strain in relationships, all these problems, jealousy, rivalry, enmity, hurts, hatred, anger, ill feeling. One area we must look very carefully into. Let the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of love, send the rays of love into our hearts, that we may be able to understand whether we are able to live together, and many of us are. Whether we are able to be related with each other, whether we are able to do exercise our mission in love with each other. You know, there's something beautiful. The first call of God to initiate a mission on this earth, the first call of God was given to Moses, the first agent of evangelization, to bring the people out of the land of Egypt. God sends him, God tells him, Moses, you go in my name and tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Go and tell them, tell Pharaoh, and set my people free. I have seen the tears of my people. I have heard the cries of my children. I have decided to intervene. You're my agent. You go in my name, in my power. The great mission given to Moses. Moses began to shiver at the burning bush. Moses began to shiver. And Moses said, oh God, please send somebody else. Send somebody else. I'm not able to be your agent. I'm not able to go and tell Pharaoh, let my people go, because I'm stammering. I have a problem. I have a weakness. I'm a stammerer. By the time I say one sentence, Pharaoh's people would have said 10 sentences. I will not inspire them. I will not impress them. I will not impress them. I know the leaders of Egypt, Pharaoh, eminent speakers. I will not impress them by your word, by your power. Please send somebody else. You know what God did? Something very strange that God did. God said, oh, Moses, I understand you. You have a problem of stammering. Therefore, you don't speak. Do not open the mouth. Let Aaron come with you, your brother. Let Aaron come with you. Aaron is an eloquent speaker. You don't open your mouth. Here is a staff. You hold it and stand there. Serious. Let Aaron speak. You go together wherever you go. Don't open your mouth. You go together wherever you go. Let Aaron speak, but you have the authority. Go together. Something very easy. God could have easily told Moses, hey, you have a problem. I want you to impress the Egyptians in my name, and therefore I heal you. Simple thing for God, right? Simple thing for God to heal Moses of his stammering, but God did not. God did not heal him of his stammering, but told him, my mission is to be done together in a relationship. Be united with Aaron, heart and mind and soul, and do your ministry together. Go together everywhere. And that's where the ministry started. The first mission of God, a ministry, a mission to be completed in a relationship. From then on, every ministry is to be exercised in a relationship. When Jesus sent his apostles to preach, what did Jesus say? Go two by two. Two by two. Exercise the ministry in a relationship. And this is what we are meant to be doing. We are meant to be people who love each other and do everything with each other. And for Jesus, our relationship with each other is so important, so important. And that's why the gospel today, John chapter 13, verses 33 onwards, my children, Jesus began to say, with a lot of affection, I'm going away. Before I go away, this is my wish, the last wish of Jesus. The last wish of Jesus. I want you to love each other, please. The Lord is telling his apostles, his disciples, I want you to love each other. I give you this commandment, the new commandment. Love each other as I have loved you. As I have loved you, love each other. But then there's a context to this new commandment, a context. The context is the washing of the feet, right? John chapter 13, that's how the 13th chapter of John begins. He loved his own. He loved them to the end. And he wanted to show the extent of his love. And what he did, he got up from the seat of authority. He removed his mantle, the mantle of a teacher. He put on the dress of a slave, a dress of humble service, and he knelt. A lot of kneeling is to be done by you and me. A lot of removing the mantle by you and me. A lot of getting up from our seats where we think we must be holding on to. A lot of getting up should be done, because that's what Jesus wants of us. He got up from the seat, removed his mantle, and took water in the basin, and he knelt at the feet of Simon Peter. He began to pour the water. Simon Peter felt water flowing on his feet. Simon Peter was flabbergasted. Oh no! Master, you can't do this to me. Understand me. You can't do this to me. I'm your disciple. You're my Lord, my Master. You can't do this to me. You cannot wash my feet. I will never allow you to do this. Unheard of in history. A master kneeling at the feet of the disciples and washing the feet. Simon Peter could not understand, began to forbid. And that's when Jesus said something very, very significant. Jesus said, Simon, if I don't wash you, you will have no participation with me. If I don't wash you, you will have no participation with me. What did Jesus mean? The participation of Simon Peter with Jesus was going to be cut off, wasn't it? Sin cuts us off from God. Simon Peter was going to deny Jesus. By the sin of denials, the participation of Simon Peter with Jesus was going to be cut off. Jesus did not want that. Jesus did not want that. Jesus did not want Simon Peter's participation with Jesus to be cut off, and therefore Jesus was washing the feet, washing away the sin before the sin is committed, washing away the effects of sin before the sin is committed. If I don't wash you, you will have no participation with me. What was Jesus doing? Jesus was sanctifying Simon Peter, wasn't he? We often interpret the washing of the feet as an act of service. It is. But much more, it was an act of redemption. It was an act of salvation. Jesus was saving Simon Peter from the sin. From the sin by which he was to hurt him, and he was in pain. That's when Jesus heard the denial. I don't know him. What are you speaking about? I don't know him. Jesus Nazareth, who is he? Three times. Jesus would be hurt. He knew that. He was a man, wasn't he? And man, in all tenderness and affection, the perfect man. He was going to be hurt. Jesus knew that. And yet, Jesus did not want that sin to cause any damage to Simon Peter. He washed that sin away. Same way, John, Thomas, even Judas, all of them were going to run away from him, and Jesus would be hurt. We are told Pilate asked him about his disciples. Jesus had no word to say. He was silent. What to say? So painful a question. So painful a question. And Judas would betray him for 30 silver pieces. And Jesus washed away all that sin. And then Jesus got up. Jesus got up, something very important, removed his service cloth, put on the dress, the mantle of the teacher, sat on the chair, now an authoritative teaching. You call me master, you call me Lord, I'm your Lord, I'm your master. How did I exercise my lordship among you? How did I exercise my lordship among you? I washed your feet. I want you to do this. I want you to do this to everyone. Everyone who would hurt you. I want you to go. Get up from the seat. Remove the mantle of all pride, of all self-righteousness, of all authority. I want you to kneel down and wash the feet. That's my commandment, new commandment. My children, I'm going away. Before that, this is my last wish. I want you to do this to each other.